Now, the next part that we'll be looking at is the extracellular matrix, which is the fluid element that comes from the fibroblasts. Again, it's that non-fibrous element of the connective tissue matrix. My good friend Greg Johnson is doing research with Sam Ward out of San Diego, and who's looking at research related to this extracellular matrix in the triceps survey. I hope we get that information out and we'll learn a lot more about the relationships of tissues in a manual therapy way. It would be really good in physical therapy. So on the slide we see a very nice picture of the collagen fibers, fibroblasts on them, and the arrow pointing to space where the extracellular matrix is going to lie, also known as ground substance in the classical sense. It's a viscous gel formed by fibroblasts and is comprised of long chains of water and carbohydrate molecules. Again, water is 60-70% of the connective tissue content. We have proteoglycan aggregates and glycoaminoglycans involved. Proteoglycans are hydration and stabilization of the extracellular matrix, which resists compressive forces. They are characterized by a core protein covalently bonded to glycoaminoglycans, or GAGs. Do you remember the chemical detail you might have learned in school about GAGs? A sugar hooked to an amine, hooked to a sugar? Probably not. When I try to go in class, I like to make it simple again. We're looking at this non-fibrous element that is the glycoamino part of that extracellular matrix. Think of hyaluronic acid that holds the water like a cotton ball. You think about the cotton ball, how light it is, but it can hold, if you put water in it, it can hold many, many times its weight in water. Hyaluronic acid's like that. It takes and holds the water up to 6 times its weight of its little protein molecules. Now, when we look at the chondroitin sulfate on the list there, you hear that, of course, you hear that mixed with glucosamine in the stores. The patients take that, of course. And it's the important part, and there are other sulfates that are in this, but primarily the sulfates 4 and 6 are gonna be the ones that are like gel or aerogel that holds the water in a shape. So if you only had hyaluronic acid, you'd be like this amorphous Jabba the Hutt of famous Star Wars fame. You'd be kind of blobbling all over the place. So what we have is the gel gives us the shape and contour of our body. So it's very important. We want to have both of those in that content. All of the structures, fibrous and non-fibrous elements, and other things earlier that we've talked about have mechanical properties. Tissues accommodate to stress by altering structure and composition to best meet the demands placed upon the matrix. The percent of the GAGs is dependent upon the demands put upon the tissue through mechanical properties. The connective tissue having injury or disease will result in disruption of the balance of these chemicals, particularly the GAGs. In the classic text, Cell Biology of Extracellular Matrix, Elizabeth Hay, MD, was a pioneer for women in science and brought much of a knowledge of the extracellular matrix to the forefront by the early 1980s. The continued works of Alfred Pischinger's work has led to the way to the findings of the matrix as a semiconducting liquid crystals with properties of transmission, storage, and processing of information key for somatic mobility and the body-wide signaling network we talked about earlier. When we can talk about connective tissue health, we want to know that it really is dependent upon the frequency and appropriate mobility of the tissues to maintain normal lubrication and what we call critical fiber distance. See the illustration below. We see epithelial cells, we see some other, we see arterioles and other fibroblasts amongst the matrix that's between it. When we have that mobility, the distance between each of those cells is maintained. If they're not, then you can have mechanical friction and other disruption, which leads to poor optimal movement and health. Mobility of ground substance is decreased with age, immobility, atrophy of muscles, and trauma. One of the mechanical properties of soft tissue is this viscoelastic nature, which we think about from school from the stress strain curve. We have a couple of instances of pictures here that show memory foam, which is a type of viscoelasticity, and we see almost a gel-like substance, which has, again, a lot of fluidity, but again, it is in a form. The key for us in relationship to viscoelasticity in a clinical setting is that it's time dependent. And this is the ability to store energy in deformation in which the application of a stress gives rise to strain that approaches its equilibrium value slowly. What does that really mean in the clinic? That means our hand's force will create a strain that might cause breakdown of tissue if put into the system too fast. Part of what you learn in the coursework is how to have the art of touch and how to use your hands in particular angles so that you slowly move into the tissue, allowing it to accept you in. In the class, I usually use this little old viscoelastic property, and we call him Mr. Viscoelastic. You can see that he's had one too many plane flights. So I'm going to show you a new device that's out, very, very cutting edge. This item is a new portion of helmets for football, and it is viscoelastic in nature. If I take and I slowly push on this, you can see that I, with time dependency, can sink way into the item without a lot of force, without a lot of strain. But if I was to hit this very hard, and that's what happens in a helmet, it gives rise to a lot of resistance to that motion. So if we go in as therapists into the tissue too hard and fast, we're going to increase a lot of stress into the person's body. We want to use the least amount of force as possible. We see the traditional stress strain curve here on the picture. The point we want to make is that we want to remember that there is usually a form of toe phase where there's creep. We saw that in the electron microscope where all tissues have that little zigzag nature to it. Then we move into the elastic phase of tissue. And in collagen that we talked about, it has a minimal amount of ability to stretch individual fibers. But do you remember when it was put together in a weave, and we use the Chinese mat as an idea to show that with weave it can move a lot more. But individual fibers, when stressed too far, will go into plastic and hysteresis. The practical point is in a clinic setting with our hands, using the least amount of force possible, using angulation, many things techniques-wise that you will learn in the class will teach you how to keep the load low, therefore bringing the strain over a longer period of time and not creating microfracturing of tissue. I think that's generally a pretty important factor. This goes off of this whole physioproxy, which is Young's modulus of elasticity. German researcher Ajo Zorn has brought a very nice hypothesis up to our attention recently, looking at the connective tissue, how it's working with the contractility that we talked about earlier. Remember alpha, smooth muscle actin? And again, its effect through a system to cause what can work through large systems like spring-like function. There is an unpublished European study that I think is going to be very interesting to see, and I hope it comes out soon. It shows where they have looked at the different fascial layers and see that the upper trapezius may have a very important initiation role in locomotion at the calcaneus. Wow, how many joints does that cover? You know, we have this human walking picture in front of us, and just to see that it's this pendulum action of the arms and the spring-like action of the lumbar fascia have the potential to facilitate energetic efficiency in walking. So we're going to be looking at the kinetic chain in the future. It's something we knew about for a long time, but really seeing it in function in the clinic will be exciting. The term tensegrity was coined by Buckminster Fuller, who is an architect. And this is a contraction of tensional integrity. The other component of the tensegrity is floating compensation, which was referenced by Kenneth Snellis. What we understand with this is the idea how ligaments, fascia, covering large areas, and you remember and see in this picture what looks like a PNF pattern on the bodies. It could be that there is some relationship to diagonals after all. And other kinds of isometry, again, how those ligaments come across the different joints, and we see the knee joint there. All of these are mechanical properties that function in a body-wise manner. Luigi Stecco is a physiotherapist from Italy, and he has postulated some new ideas related to myofascial units. You see in the picture that we're using some lettering there that's really coming off the Latin terms for the different part. But his postulation is that different fascial planes and areas are connected both mechanically and by neural elements that can give rise to, again, information for movement, but it also can give rise to pain patterns. So again, some of this referred pain that we always look at could come from these different myofascial units. Centers, sequences, and spirals are new terms introduced to understand the myofascial units' kinetic neuromechanical relationships. Look for more of this in the literature, especially from the dynamic research of the Luigi relations, Carla, Antonio, both MD researchers. I would like, however, to know that for many, many years, probably over the 25 years that I've taught with the Institute, there have been much discussion of tissue and having spirals, having certain center points or still points of where dysfunctions occur. So even though this is an interesting information coming from Italy, I think also we have credit to Greg for seeing a lot of these same ideas in different forms over the last 20 plus years. So with connective tissue, we've already mentioned the Helene Lavigne's PhD work that was printed in 2006 on body-wide signaling network. Remember, that's the relationship that the nervous system, the extracellular matrix, gives rise to information and possible contractility through those alpha smooth muscle actin. It also mechanically works through that idea of the cross fibers that look PNF-like here on the one side, with the thoracolumbar fascia being the primary area of research presently because of the increased amount of mechanoreceptors and various other receptors. So this helps us understand that there are mechanical forces that drive through the system have an effect to this electrical, cellular, and tissue remodeling dynamics. When we are looking at pathophysiological models related to what's going on with the tissue, we want to know that the neuromusculoskeletal pain is an integration of connective tissue plasticity mechanisms and pain psychology, postural control, and neuroplasticity. Very classic works of various authors that we've already mentioned, Arum and Madden, certainly Salter with his CPM, have looked at substrates of healing. We know that early on we have a reaction phase in the first couple minutes of an injury, which has a lot of chemicals that set up inflammatory stage, which then goes on up to several weeks, but usually is very evident in the first couple 2 to 3 days. After that, we have proliferation phase up to 5 days, and this is where fibrogenesis is at really starting to work to build the tissue up. And then finally, we go into a maturation phase, which can begin at 2 to 3 weeks and go up to more than a year or so. When we think about scar tissue healing stages, and we talked about the substrates earlier, do remember the substrates are just a guideline. At any given time in the human body, there is overlap of all of these going on, and they just have their greater effect of one stage to the other. But in scar healing, you see on this picture here that we know that we get a high production of scar tissue within the first 21 days. It might be a very good time for us to do manual therapy to really try to direct the stresses into the tissue to lay down properly. You remember how we talked about the fibroblast spewing out all of its amino acids in both fibrous and non-fibrous elements. So we really want to affect that very importantly. But it's important also to realize that about 6 to 8 weeks, the tensile strength of scar is poor. So that's a time when we don't want to be using force. So if in the guidelines of what we teach you in the course, you're using the proper techniques without force, you can work on things through this period without worrying about damaging an individual's recovery. Thereafter, again, 14 weeks it says on here, scar elongation is poor, and we start to get problems with trying to change scar. Any of you who have worked with burn victims know how the eschar can be very difficult to get loose. At this point, we're probably not working on scar tissue with our manual therapy, but on its connection to the fascial tissue, and we stretching or changing the extracellular matrix to allow the scar tissue to move more mobile. Scar tissue is good. It's part of our healing process. Lastly, at 6 months to 1 year, we have a lot of return of the tensile strength. So both that's a good thing as long as we have general mobility of the scar within its area. So related to dysfunctions that we'll be trying to attempt to analyze and diagnose in the class, we know that abnormal healing leads to this hypertrophic scar potential, excessive fibrosis, and collagen synthesis. Interfiber cross-linking from trauma, immobilization, and unchanging intercept points can occur. Langevin, that I mentioned earlier, has shown that in the thoracolumbar shear strain was 20% less in people with chronic low back pain. Compensated movements and or intrinsic connective tissue pathology occurs. What are the effects of immobilization on connective tissue? We know that we lose glycoaminoglycans 30 to 40%. And with this, we have an increased rate of degeneration of mature collagen fibers, increased proliferation of new immature collagen fibers, and the loss of the critical fiber distance I mentioned, the space between the collagen and elastin, leading to interfiber cross-linking of new fibers with existing fibers at particular intercept points. This is from excellent work from Atkinson, Wu, and Mill, who are the top leading researcher of connective tissue. When we get interfiber cross-linking, one of the earliest type of cross-link would be a hydrogen bond. It's the weakest bond. So sometimes you may find yourself doing soft tissue work and you say, wow, that just seemed to really change quickly. It's probably a hydrogen bond. But if it stays in its place and gets a little bit more adhered, it becomes a covalent bond, which you remember from chemistry is a much stronger bond. And if it continues to do that, it can always work to becoming a fibrotic or adhesed type of tissue or scar. And this becomes much more difficult to change with our hands in the body. When we think about scar tissue or fibrosis, you know, we often think that we're working on body tissues like joints and we think, wow, we've got really hard fibrotic tissue. But really, this research is starting to show we might have to think differently about that. There's an unpublished study coming out of a university in Southern California region that shows that the fibrosis might be able to be affected by certain electrical currents. The study is where they're putting a trauma into the abdomen of monkeys. They let the scar form. They open them up surgically. Then they go in with this electrical current and they found what is measured as hard dynamic fibrosis or scar can be turned to a gel or liquefied with these particular electric currents. And what does that really mean? What does that mean as far as are fibrosis adhesion truly just purely mechanical? Or is it this body-wide signaling system, what's going along with electricity in the body? So these are things that have been talked about for many years, but we're really seeing these new research come out to give us a whole new understanding of different kinds of dysfunctions in the body. You know, I really loved in school doing physics, and I love seeing when we can apply it in the clinic. Now, I know these pictures look a little bit odd, but what you see is one that has full excursion and one that has crosslinks that limit extensibility. I'm from the Northwest. This actually, in physics, is called a dashpot. A dashpot is like a spring with a hydraulic device you have on a storm door. And so what we see here is when we bind down at certain intercept points, then you're going to lose excursion of the tissue. So this is a very mechanical physics way to look at what restrictions might be. I wanted just to, at this point, slide in this list of famous researchers, and just so you can be aware of all the people that are doing some of the newest and most cutting-edge research and studies on fascia and what we're doing with manual therapy. It's really important to realize that we have these individuals that are taking us from the day when we thought of things as individual types of biology. You know, we had elastin, we had collagen, we had muscles, we had ligaments, and never separated, or there was no symbiosis, right? For a long time, we've talked about understanding kinetic chain, that the body works together through a whole body, but it's so difficult in a clinic to be able to see that, even though you know it. So what's really nice now is that we're starting to see the science put together what we knew in the clinic, this understanding that the fascia works through long distances like we talked about with Ida Rolf's sweater idea, that the body had some contractility to it. We knew that there was a relationship to that, and now we're seeing that evidenced in the research. And again, the fantastic studies that are going down in neuroscience that all of you are so on top of, I'm sure, compared to me even. And when we look at those, that area of neuroscience, we can now understanding that everything is complexly intertwined in this beautiful body that we work with every day. So we've had a lot of discussion of a lot of detail of, again, connective tissue. But let's talk about where this really comes to home in the clinic. You know, looking at soft tissue compensations and issues. We have problems with functional excursion, accessory play, altered end feel, tearing, abnormal tone, and swelling. These are all things that we have to address on our patients. In soft tissue mobilization, once you understand what we're trying to do with all this, again, scientific evidence, is put it together where we have a systematic management system for the identification and specific treatment of soft tissue dysfunction. The emphasis is on the enhancement of functional capacity as well as symptom reduction. Various possible effects of soft tissue mobilization can be made from all the things that we talked about. Certainly mechanical, you know, the relationship of mobilizing scar tissue and crosslinks, viscoelastic, the mechanical elongation, tensegrity ideas that we talked about, hydration. We talked about how important hydration is for the lubrication and mobility in the tissues and needing of excess fluids. And then the ground substance or extracellular metrics, normalization. and how important that is now with the understanding of how intricate it is for mobility, and again, that body-wide signaling system. Neuroreflexive, it's those neuromyofascial changes, the entire neurosciences that we're delving into that can be related to problems. I know for me, many of the types of soft tissue issues I believe people have are neuroreflexive. And with skills that you'll learn in this course, you'll be able to make faster changes than some other types of paradigms with changes of soft tissue tone and dysfunction. So that's my personal opinion and why I love this information. But neuroreflexive is such an important area. And lastly, the electrochemical area, where I said this is the whole new area of research that's going on right now that's really being understood at a much better level. So particularly in learning in the course is the ability to really be specific and to understand that what we hope for you is to have treatment that's directed into a central aspect of identified dysfunction, and that you'll have a lot of ability to find the specificity through location, depth, and direction. So when we look at soft tissues of functions, this course will particularly looking at a type of layer approach that's unique from all other courses. Here you have listed skin and superficial fascia to the myofascial levels and even neurovascular mobility. You see under myofascia, we talked about earlier muscle play. Do you remember muscle play is the ability for tissues to glide upon each other, whether that be bone, fascia, or muscle. Muscle tone is something that is supertentorial. It's set up by the person's mind on how they are holding tension in their body, and it's so important to engage people to be able to change that. And certainly length and the idea of dynamic excursion, so much more important than what the old school type of stuff of just stretching everything. A good case example would be for me thinking about how many people have forward head, and you find your patient have a very rigid, stiff levator scapula, right? It's supposed to elevate the shoulder, but it ends up being a clavicle for the neck. It holds the head up. And at that same point where it attaches at the superior border, it often gets enmeshed with the serratus posterior superior and with the subscapular muscle, creating a vector force that pulls differently and causes a dysfunctional axis of rotation. We know the scapula should move approximately from the middle of the spinal scapula. So when it's moving from that improper axis of rotation, now the rotator cuff become very strained. So things have, again, action that occurs at distance. So there's one of muscle play. Now tone is a different thing. How many of you have ever had somebody have a headache or muscles in the suboccipitals that are very tight and you work on them and you feel like you do a really good job of releasing the tension in there? But they go outside and somebody honks a horn and there it is, it's back again. Because tone is supertentorial. And in those cases, we really have to engage and work with patients to become knowledgeable and sense their own body tension. So we have to be really a mechanical and again, exercise neuromuscular type of therapist in total to be able to affect good change in our people. So, you know, here we have a really nice picture of an anterior thigh. You see the spine centrally and the pelvis, and then you can see the sartorius that overlaps with the rectus femoris and the VMO and the lateralis. What's interesting, though, in the class, what you're going to be able to do is look at those different tissues and be able to evaluate along lines of the parallel nature of that underneath. Imagine this was a client of yours that came in, was playing sports and had a contusion into the thigh, and that contusion was under the sartorius. We know the sartorius has a little bit of hip flexion, but it's a lot of it's going to get external rotation and abduction. The rectus is more of a pure knee extensor to this degree. If you change that force vector, now what's going to happen to the movement quality of those two muscles if they're, again, plastered together with a contusion? We're going to be coming in and we're going to be looking at the functional spaces that Grotz talked about earlier, and we're going to be able to explore through those in this class that you're going to be taking, and it's really exciting to be able to find all the functional joints that you can with your hands. We like to show this picture. It's from an older case study, but it's a classic one. This guy was wanting to be a dancer, I understand, and when he was in a injury, and he said he was mugged, he got a traumatic injury to his thorax, which you can see is quite in a shifted position, and again, quite a bit of change. Just look at it closely, and you can see that there is a zigzag nature to his spine. Look at the arm windows. You can see big space on the left compared to that. And even in his hand position, you can see the rotation. So this is a traumatic scoliosis. You see the changes in his scapular heights with each other. And if you look closely, you can even see a torsional twisting through the and spiraling of the tissue in his right leg. Now, the things that you're learning in class, particularly are what we're going to be working at. Here you can see after 10 visits that there is change within his positioning. The armhole is on the left, is the window on that side is much smaller, his rotation through his body is different, the scapular heights are different, and even in the legs, if you look closer, you see a lot of a less torsional nature. Now he did have 10 extensive visits with soft tissue mobilization, neuromuscular reeducation, some joint mobilization. But what's interesting in his functional change was that he was working up to be at a certain level in dance because he wanted to be go to New York and be a professional dancer. And what was able to occur was his a fast change in his function over this 10 visit period, and he was off to New York, which is really exciting for him, without the pain that he had originally. Now this last slide's put together, we want to just show from his initial visits to 10 visits to 1 year later. Well, certainly he got a better tan. And we didn't mean to have him no underwear for a particular reason, but to show you that there was things that aren't totally worked out with his problem. Can you see the right gluteal area being very constricted and tight? It's like he has a gluteal wink there. So we want to see that even when you think you do a good job and a person's doing more function, there's always more to look at. But the important thing is that people always ask, when you make the physical changes on people, will it last? And we like to see that on this picture, it shows a good sustaining of his posture alignment. And again, he was doing quite well with his dance. The other thing to go along with this is that for you in this class that you're going to be studying, it seems like this is a lot of work that only someone really expertise can do. And we want you to know that with the right principles and the right skills that you're going to learn, this is the same kind of work that you can do and make great changes on your patients, which is, gives you a lot of, again, a joy and happiness to in service to your patients. Just to finalize, I'd like to thank and acknowledge certainly my very good friend Greg Johnson, who is the creator and developer of this course and the material. Also would like to thank those that did secondary changes and updates to the lecture. One of them, Jim Bazell, who is a longstanding instructor that we all cared about a lot, died recently and we miss him greatly. Also wanted to thank the physical therapist that supported me with some literature review, particularly with annotated summaries that would help with the volume of new research. Thank you guys very much for the help that you provided.